Michael Jackson is back in action with his new album, Thriller. Thriller, Michael's new album featuring his latest hit, Billie Jean.
In the world of popular music, there's always an artist that defines their respective decade. For instance, the 1960s saw the rise of Beatlemania, while more currently the 2010s have been defined by Drake. For better or for worse, that's up to you. But that's not what we're going to talk about. Instead, I want to look at a very specific time period, the 80s, and its most undisputed icon, Michael Jackson. All through the late 70s, the 1980s, and the early 90s, people couldn't get enough of this guy. He was all you needed in an artist. The voice, the moves, the style. Audiences were absolutely starstruck. And an artist that big, something's gotta come from that. And I think it's all thanks to a little album called Thriller. Now, of course, when I say little, I mean one of the biggest selling albums of all time. When it came out, it was unstoppable, earning Jackson 8 Grammy Awards in 1984 and 7 singles from a 9-track album. And while a lot of those singles like Beat It and Thriller are certified bangers on their own, I think the biggest testament to the success of this album, through Michael Jackson himself, was Billie Jean. When you hear the name Michael Jackson, this is the song you hear, while imagining him in a fedora and a sparkly jacket wearing a white glove and doing the moonwalk, among other things. One's gotta ask, why was this song so big? Why is it still so big? And how did it gain so much staying power to stay relevant today? That's what we're here today to find out. Welcome to Hit History, the podcast where we look at tunes you love and then analyze the moments in history that make them as big as they are. For today's episode, we're taking a look at the success of Michael Jackson's Billie Jean. So, where do we start on this? Well, let's create a little scenario. You're Michael Jackson. Yeah, this is a bit weird, so just bear with me. You've released Off the Wall, your 5th solo studio album, and your first within the deal with Epic Records. The album is critically acclaimed, and people finally recognize you as a mature artist in your own right. So you decide to start a new project, Thriller. This album would be bigger and better than the last, further cementing you as a big artist. And the sound of the album needed to reflect that. But where would you find that kind of revolutionary sound? I mean, it's gonna be a 1 in a million chance, like finding a needle in a haystack, right? Well, if you're Michael Jackson, the answer is surprisingly clear. In a Rolls Royce. It was the summer of 1982. Michael Jackson had just finished another day recording at the studio and was commuting home with producer Quincy Jones through the LA Ventura Freeway. Suddenly, an idea comes to his head. A bass line. As Michael Jackson says himself.
For instance, when creating the song Billie Jean, I was riding in my car and it started with the bass lick again, which goes. And on top of that, I hear the chord. Then the melody, she was more like a beauty queen from a movie scene. I said, oh mama, do you mean I am one? And the lyrics, the strings, the chords, everything comes at that moment like a gift that is put right into your head. And that's how I hear it.
As every piece came together, it seemed like the song was finally taking shape. Suddenly, a young man on a motorcycle rode up beside his car and knocked on the window and said, "Sir, your car is on fire." He was so absorbed in the tune that he didn't notice that the entire undercarriage of his car was up in flames, and he almost had a near brush with death, but even that couldn't stop him. As soon as he got home, he got to work. He started composing the entire tune with composing the rhythm track on a tiny drum machine and nailing the vocals in one take. He also wanted to get a distinct sound for the vocals, but he didn't really have the time to use the latest equipment. So he resorted to using a more lo-fi alternative, which was to record a good amount of the vocals through a cardboard tube. I think it was around 6 foot or something like that. I mean, that's pretty impressive. Oh yeah, and also, the song was mixed 91 times. I mean, most songs will probably go through maybe once, twice, but 91 times, that's a lot. So apparently the reason for mixing the song 91 times is because they wanted to get the specific drum beat that would fit best with the song. And I mean, that makes sense, because the beat is pretty iconic. It's the first thing you hear in the track. Speaking of which, we should talk about the final record and how it holds up. And if I must say myself, it's sonically brilliant. So, what exactly does it entail? Well, we start with a classic four-on-the-floor drum beat, which is basically when the kick drum is played on all four beats in a 4-4 time. Then we're introduced to a repeating bass line. Now, apparently, producer Quincy Jones later notes that it was stolen from a song called State of Independence, or a Hall & Oates song called I Can't Go For That, No Can Do. It's all up in the air, and it could really go either way. And I don't think it's that similar, but I could see why someone would think that. But anyways, let's get on to the actual track itself. After that, a synth starts playing three notes, and we establish the chord progression that would go on throughout the song. By the time the second bridge comes in, we're introduced to strings, which sound mournful and dramatic, as well as a electronic wind instrument and a killer guitar solo. Now, it doesn't sound all that amazing when I describe it, but it's something you just need to listen to. It just makes you want to dance. It's one of those songs, like many Michael Jackson songs actually. They always establish, you know, a good rhythm track, they always establish a good bass line, you know. Those things kind of get you in the groove, make you want to move, you know? And all of this is also backed up by some pretty depressing lyrics. It tells a story of lust, deception, and paranoia. In the song, Michael meets a girl by the name of Billie Jean on a dance floor. She ends up tempting him into coming to her bedroom for a different kind of dancing. But she came and stood right by me. I just smell a sweet perfume. This happened much too soon. She called me to her room. Hey. Before long, she starts accusing Michael of being the father of her child. She's just a girl who claims that I am the one. But the kid is not my son. No. When asked about the inspiration in an interview in Thailand, Michael noted that it was mainly inspired by groupies who were in relationships with his brothers during his Jackson 5 years. However, it's also been said that it could have been inspired by a woman in Jackson's later life, who would stalk him and send him letters about a son that she thought was his. It kinda messed him up a bit, he had nightmares about it, and there was a situation with a gun, and he ended up getting the picture framed on his wall. It's weird. Look it up, because I don't really want to get into this. It's kind of icky for a podcast. Of course, all these lyrics are emphasized by the killer vocals that we mentioned earlier, and all the little hiccups and inflections that appear in his vocals. The song was released as the second single on Thriller after The Girl Is Mine, featuring Paul McCartney, on January 22nd, 1983, and it's a critical and commercial success, staying on the number one spot in the Billboard Hot 100 for 7 weeks and selling, as of today, 10 million copies worldwide. I mean, that's pretty impressive. So, it was natural that Michael wanted to make a music video to help accompany this. He just needed the right guy. Luckily, around this time, the music video for Human League's Don't You Want Me was gaining regular rotation, and Michael Jackson liked it so much that he chose the director, Steve Barron, to work on Billie Jean. I guess he liked it because he saw the kind of noir style that he was going for, and he really wanted that kind of dark, moody atmosphere for a song about, you know, stalkers. After discussing what could be done with their budget, they finally came up with the concept that we see in the video. A man with a Midas touch being stalked by a gumshoe detective through a moody cityscape. And, you know, dancing along the way to meet his girlfriend, then he eventually disappears and walks off into the night. You know, the usual noir story. We all know this music video by now, right? Michael Jackson's iconic leather jacket, red bow tie, pink shirt, the path that lights up every time Michael Jackson steps on a square, the moody cityscape with the purple evening sky. It's absolutely amazing to watch. If you haven't watched it, I suggest you watch it. It's something you need to see. And yeah, it seemed like this would be a hit among TV audiences. So if they felt, yeah, let's put this out. There was one problem though. When approached by Jackson and Baron, MTV refused to air the music video. Now, the reason as to why is complicated. Some say that it was due to racial discrimination, which is fair since they also rejected Rick James's Super Freak clip. I mean, that can't really be a coincidence, right? But also, a lot of people say that it was due to MTV wanting to stay rock-centered as they were trying to be a rock station at the time. Whichever way you put it, this was bad news for Michael and his team. So bad, in fact, that when the president of CBS Records, Walter Yetnikoff, caught wind of this, he actively went and threatened MTV into playing the music video. And it was quite violent. Well, not violent, but just very threatening. He recounts it in the book, I Want My MTV.
I said, I'm pulling everything we have off the air, all of our product. I'm not going to play any of your videos, and I'm telling them about the fact you don't want to play music by a black guy.
There's no way that you can listen to a threat like that and not do whatever they're saying. So, of course, MTV put the music video on regular and then soon heavy rotation, and audiences loved it. The Billie Jean video was a pivotal moment in music video history as a whole. It further launched Michael's career with his Beat It and Thriller videos following soon after the Billie Jean one. It was the start of a new wave of black artists coming onto MTV and slowly breaking down the color line that existed there. And it got MTV a slew of good ratings, and it brought them into the mainstream as it is now. So, an iconic song and an iconic video to boot. I mean, it could just end there, right?
What exactly is the Motown sound? What?
Motown 25. Yesterday, today, forever. It's everyone together on one stage for one night to relive 25 years of Motown. Now,
it's May 1983, and Motown, where Michael began as an artist, is holding a 25th anniversary television special. A slew of big artists were set to appear, such as Marvin Gaye, Stevie Wonder, and the Jackson 5. However, while the other four brothers were easy to get on board, Michael was a very different story. When approached during a studio session, Michael at first refused due to his negative views on television. Apparently, he really didn't like it for some reason. Eventually, he came to an agreement with the person who came to visit him. He said that, yes, he would perform with his brothers on stage, but only if he could perform Billie Jean in a solo spot. On May 15th, 1983, Motown 25 was broadcast with an appearance by Michael Jackson and the Jackson 5. It was the first time the group had performed together in 8 years, and everybody was there for it. Needless to say, they loved it. But after that sweet reunion, it was soon time.
Those were good songs. I like those songs a lot, but especially I like the new songs.
And thus began one of the greatest live performances to ever exist. Now, do I think this is an overstatement, that it's just some guy walking around on stage?
No, I don't think it's an overstatement. For one thing, Michael Jackson owns the stage. You know you have Live Aid, where Freddie Mercury just absolutely dominated the stage so much that he got him to sing, you know, along with him? It's that exact same energy that Michael has. He walks around that stage like he owns it, the footwork is immaculate, he just knows how to convey the lyrics that he's singing. It's absolutely nuts. I'm going completely off script here, just so you know. And it's amazing. In fact, the most breathtaking part, I don't even need to show to you. You don't need to see it. You can just hear it, and you'll know how important it was. Listen to that. The audience went nuts for it at this time. It wasn't even new then. It was done by street performers all the time in the 70s, and it was also done on Soul Train by a certain group. I can't remember the name. But the point is, Michael Jackson was that big of a star and that talented that he managed to pull it off live on stage and make it his own. This was the one night where Michael Jackson went from pop star to music icon. It was massive. So, looking at these three moments in time, I think it's pretty easy to see why Billie Jean as a song stayed in the public conscience for so long, why Michael Jackson stayed there for so long. I mean, to make a perfect hit song followed by an iconic music video and then by one of the greatest televised performances ever, no easy feat, but he did it. The man did it. And I think through this period, Michael Jackson earned the title as the one and only King of Pop.